Minglaba. It is such a great privilege to be here to see you. I don't know if I have seen any of you in Yangon or anywhere else in Myanmar.
Maybe someone,
I don't know. I've been there many times. My first time, thank you, was in
1988.
It was a wonderful experience to be in Yangon. After that, there has been many, many more times. I don't know, maybe 50, 60, 100 times, many times. When I was 22 years old, I went to the mission field the first time. I went as a short-term missionary to India.
India, kum tom no om tu China kapai masa.
Belgium, all the way through Europe, and then to the Middle East, and then all the way to India and Pakistan.
Truck takipan mo, takipan Sweden mo kapai. Sese tabanga.
I spent time in Afghanistan and Pakistan. I spent 2 years. I was 22 years old. And those 2 years that I spent there changed my life. When we expose ourselves to God to be touched by Him, He will touch us. Something takes place inside. You see, I come from a non-Christian background. My mother and father are like chin families. In the sense that they have many, many brothers and sisters. My mother has 9 siblings. My father has 9 siblings. I have many cousins and aunties and uncles. But there was no one who was a Christian when I grew up. I didn't know anything about God. I had never been to church. I say I was in church only 3 times before I became a Christian.
The
first time when I was 6 months old. And my mother and father had me someone to sprinkle my head with water. The second time when I went through confirmation classes, I was 12 or 13 years old.
Confirmation chia Catholic
na pian hi. The third time when my grandmother died and there was a funeral.
Atum na kapai na ila kapia chila hi ya. Ta sala se se bia in thang hi.
I come from a gentle, completely heathen background.
Ena pachen hangi ngor pachen umngi ngor background pan na hong pai ngit
ke hi. But something salvation happened to me because Jesus saved me.
Mupket na ila ke kung hong thang hi.
I was on the way of committing suicide.
I was
19 years old. And I was depressed.
And I
didn't want to live.
I made
a rope and I put it on the motor, my motorcycle, and I drove to the forest to hang myself.
But
on the way to the forest, I stopped by a church camp.
And there
was a big signboard by the roadside.
And
the signboard read, Jesus for
life. I didn't
know anything about Jesus.
I
knew I have, you know, I had read the Bible a little bit, but I didn't know Jesus.
But
those words touched
me.
And instead of going continue to the forest, I went back to my home.
And I
sat down on my bed.
And
I said, is there a God out
there?
If there is a God,
would
you come into my life? Touch my
life.
Live your life in me.
That
was not a prayer full of faith, was it?
It
was just an open door. Someone opens the door and someone comes in.
And that
night I did receive Jesus to be my Savior.
Now
that night I came to understand what the grace of God is.
It
was nothing I could do.
It
was nothing I did.
Nothing
I could deserve.
Simply
say, God, come.
And
the Spirit of God came.
Now,
our entire life are to be lived in such a way
that
we give up and we just trust God.
Because
grace is to come into this salvation we never deserved.
God brings
us in.
Okay.
But also our continual walk is to be in the same way.
Nothing
that we do, but God does through us.
Amen. Amen.
And this I came to learn quite quickly in my life.
I said,
I went to the mission field when I was 22 years old. When I was 22, I went to be a mission field.
Mission field, I have just
turned
58.
I am 1 month, 10 days older than Pastor Mung Tong. I'm 40 days older than Pastor Mung Tong.
Nisom Li Lian. Sa Mung Tong Sang na kaham zo hi.
I learned very, very soon because I came into situations where I seemed to walk into something and things just happened to my life. Everything, when I look back today of our missionary work, it has happened in that way. I want to read the book of Ruth.
ruta sungkasim nomhi.
Now the book of Ruth is a story about how the grace of God comes into a Gentile woman and she becomes part of the family of Israel or family of God.
Ruta tu ison takchang gender minamte sunga pachine tu chemna bangbanga hongtum jem chi sesia e terothek tu hi.
She becomes a grandmother to King David.
Amasesia rutsesia David kum pipa I api.
She was a Gentile woman.
Amasesia Gentile te hi Israel minamte bohingor hi.
She had no part in the covenant of God.
But
by the grace of God, hand is reaching out and bringing this Gentile woman into covenant relationship.
Now, of course,
we know that this is a picture of how the church, I mean, the Gentiles in the world comes in and becomes a covenant people like you and me.
To says about the bang yem jene por pi jantar te pachieni tu jem su om ngol te se pachien na hong samaja ama tu jem su hong sap na se to ki bang den mai.
And the one who is doing that in this passage is Boaz. His name is Boaz, right?
Amai alompa boa mo bo bo a.
He is a picture, a type of Jesus Christ. That means through Jesus Christ, a hand of God is stretched out to bring Gentiles into a relationship with God.
It's
a story of the grace of God. It is God's active. God is doing something, and man is just receiving. It's like the Samaritan, the Good Samaritan.
Samaritan, mi papa tokibang hi.
The Good Samaritan is out walking, and he sees this man who has been robbed and been beaten. He is bleeding by the roadside.
Samaritan, mi papa sese tabanga.
The man cannot do anything for himself. He's just sick, he's weak, he has no money. But the Good Samaritan takes him in. It's a picture of the grace of God poured into a person.
Now,
this whole story of Ruth is a picture of God's grace coming to us.
There
are some things that God spoke to me very early in my ministry, for many, many years ago.
That
has really helped me to understand how God can work through our lives. I've had a prayer that I prayed for many years now. Lord, I want to be at the right place, at the right time, and to meet the right people. And it's amazing.
If I know
I'm at that converging point, I know God's grace is being poured out.
I was
in India some years ago.
We were
having evangelistic healing crusades.
Someone
asked me, please come to visit this man. He cannot come to the meetings.
I took
my interpreter, we went to the house.
And we didn't know
what was waiting inside. boom, 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 knocking on the door. I knocked. And someone says, come in. We opened the door and we took one step into the building. And he was a man laying on the bed. He was tuberculosis. He was dying. He hadn't eaten for a long time. He had pain all across his body. And his family had called for other relatives because they expected him to die.
We didn't
know that. But so we stepped into the building. And here's this man. Suddenly he's jumping up from his bed. And he's saying something in Hindi. I don't understand Hindi. He's saying something. And I asked my interpreter, what's going on here? He says he has been healed. Healed? How can that be? We haven't prayed for him yet. We haven't prayed yet. He was healed. But you know what else? He repented, he received the Lord Jesus. His family received Jesus.
They had
a lot of idols from, you know, Hindu idols.
And
they were tearing down all the wallpaper and all the idols from the walls. And later on he was baptized and his family. I
said,
who did anything? We did not do anything. He didn't do anything. I mean, he only believed that if we would come to his house, maybe he should be healed. Because he had heard a rumor, you know, from the meetings.
But
to me, it was a big surprise. But I stepped into something. I call this the footsteps of God.
Where
God has prepared something. And we just walk into it and even not knowing what's going to happen. The night I was going to hang myself, God had prepared something for me. I walked into the grace of God. And then the grace of God begins to work in us. He changes our thinking, our hearts. And we desire to do what he wants to do.
Yeah.
Philippians chapter 2 verse 13 talks about that. That he works in us so that we would like to do his will. He works into us his power so that we also have the necessary power to do his will. I'm not saying that it is easy. I mean, I've been a missionary since I was 22 and now I'm 58 now.
There are
difficult times. There are times when you don't have some money. You may not have food on the table. You may want to give up. Maybe you're weak or sick. But in the midst of that situation, God's grace is so marvelous and so wonderful. And many times, we don't know that he has already prepared something. But he has prepared and he's working inside of us.
I think
that all the ministries that we have started over the years, we have started in Myanmar. I met Pastor Mung Tong
in 1988.
That was just the time when there was a very big problem. The demonstrations beginning. Pastor Mung was a very thin man. And his English was very bad. His English was very bad. Amen. His church was 15 members big. Now he is a bit changed now.
Yeah.
But I met him by chance. I thought it was chance. By a coincidence, I met him in Singapore. But he was not God's, it was not coincidence, it was God's appointment. When I went to Nepal 5 years ago, I met a man, he's a pastor. I didn't think much about it, but God had prepared. Wow, he had given him a vision. He had seen me in a vision. And we started a ministry. When I came back to Sweden 4 years ago, I'm not living in Singapore any longer. I met one friend, an Arab friend of mine. He was not my friend then. I met him.
Arab lom tekat nong kaki muhi.
And I shook his hand and I say, my name is Hakan.
Amato kuklen se kan min se Hakan.
I said, I know. I have met you before.
Amana heki hi ni dang komung ayo hong chi hi.
What?
Bangyam?
Yeah. 2.5 years before I met him, he had a vision. Of my me and my family. He knew my name, he knew my family faces. He had seen in a vision. And we started a work together now. The Middle East is opening for the gospel of the Lord Jesus. He has seen thousands of Muslims come to Jesus. When I went to India,
96,
I walked into a situation and there was a woman who had seen a vision of me and my friend some weeks before. And we started a ministry in India. Today the ministry is like 250 churches. Last year the brothers and the sisters, they baptized almost 2,000 Hindus to Jesus.
So,
and we have started schools, we have started feeding programs, we started many other things.
And
I don't understand how that happened.
It's
simply because someone was prepared and I met that person at that perfect time. This is what happening here in the book of Ruth also. And the grace of God prepares the way, the grace of God comes in, and the grace of God works through the woman. Ruth and her husband, they are Jews. They live in the promised land, but there is a drought coming, and they don't have any, you know, no good time.
Ruti pasalte obna sese ju ngam hia. Aiyang talamuna kiel tungtana
they move away from the promised land. Their two sons marry two women. They were not Jewish people. They were Moabites. The Jews was not supposed to marry Moabites women. They are breaking the law of God. They have a big problem there in the land. The boys die, husband dies, and the sons die. They die. It's a hopeless situation. It's poverty. They are poor. So the woman decides to return to Israel.
And
we know that this story, that the two daughter-in-laws, they follow her a bit until one daughter-in-law leaves, but the one, Ruth, she follows all the way back. Now, let us read at the beginning of the end of chapter 1. When this woman Naomi and Ruth, they come back to Israel, Naomi is saying this about her situation. Verse 20, do not call me Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has testified against me and the Almighty has afflicted me?
Tugale Naomi huye mkoba ne, Mara huye koba. Anana dgoshi di nga a alun kado aya pira mubi. Ngadi jewa pisung de tatoa I. Yaku muga sinye le dgoreshima tawrapyadi nga gu piampo do mubi. Tawrapyadi nga gu nincha yu, anana dgoshi di nga gu sinye sira mudi pi yu.
Her attitude is not very nice, I would say. The Lord has brought this upon me. We were full when we went away. But now we are empty, we have nothing left. The Lord has afflicted me. You read the story, there's a negative attitude here. Blaming their problem on God. We know it was not God's fault. It was their own fault they went away to a land they shouldn't have gone. And they faced hardships there. It was difficult. The sons died. The husband died. It speaks to us also. It speaks to us in our lives as well when we face difficulties and hardships. How is our attitude? Is it that we want to blame others for our situation? Well, there will be no solution just by blaming other people.
But
this is clearly seen in her life, in Ruth. In Naomi. And then in chapter 2, we see Ruth, beginning of chapter 2.
Ruth 2 says,
verse 2. Ruth the Moabitess said to Naomi, please let me go to the field and glean heads of grain after him in whose sight I may find favor. And she said to her, go, my daughter. Then she left and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers, and she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was the family of Elimelech. Now Boaz, behold, came from Bethlehem at that time and said to the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered him, the Lord bless you.
Now this
is the beginning of the story. Ruth, what kind of attitude?
Ruth na amai.
Let me go out. I will surely find someone who will show favor to me.
And she went.
And she just, the Bible says here, she happened to come to that field.
And
exactly at the same moment, another man, Boaz, happened to come to that field because it was his field. And he came from Jerusalem or from Bethlehem. It happened to.
And when
I read this many years ago, the Lord spoke to my heart very clearly.
That
the grace of God is released when there is an expectation that we will receive good things. She went out expecting favor. In spite of the bad situation they had been in, she expected God will do something.
And then
supernaturally, she was led to just come to that moment when this man came at the same time.
So
and out of that meeting, something began to take place.
You know,
many years ago, when I went out to mission field first time, I had a church in Sweden. I was a member of a church in Sweden.
They
were going to pray for me to send me and my family away.
And
after prayer, one lady came up to me.
And
she had a piece of paper in her hand.
And
she said, I met this woman. It was a name on this piece of paper.
I
met this woman in Moscow, in the airport hotel in Moscow. My friend, this lady that came to me, her husband had been murdered. She was a missionary, but her husband was murdered in Kenya.
And
she met this other lady. She was also a widow.
So they had common interest
and they exchanged the names and the addresses.
And
if the lady in the church said to me, or maybe you will see this lady. She lives in Malaysia.
The salad on the pinu came up to Bangchim Chile. There's a room to me, a mass in Malaysia or Michina.
We were going to Singapore.
The salad goes to Singapore.
Okay, maybe we'll see this lady.
The salad on the pito came up to China.
But there are many people living in Asia.
I am Asia, I mean, Tampita Omitana.
I may not meet this woman ever in my life. Anyway, I took the piece of paper and put it in my pocket. Only 1 month after we arrived to Singapore to live there.
Singapore,
we were sitting in the church. And then we have to stand up and you say, "Hello, hello. Nice to meet you." You greet your neighbor, the people in the pew. And when this lady said her name, a bell started to ring in my mind. Wow, the same name as in my paper. The same name, the woman was that piece of paper. Oh, the woman was on my piece of paper.
I said,
what is the likelihood that this thing can happen? It's not a chance. Must be something behind this.
He says,
no. Why? Because I pray that prayer. And I believe God answered that prayer. It is not like you have a light on your path and you walk, you know God's will and God's path.
But
God works in our emotions.
In our
will.
In
our thinking. He is at work in us.
And
if we just love God, we are in love with Him. We worship Him. And we are conscious of Him. And we want Him to be in a part of our life.
He will
definitely change our thinking and our mind and our emotions.
So
that we automatically we want to do His will and we walk His will.
We
may not have a clear leading like a prophecy or a vision or a dream. Maybe not.
Prophecy. It
could just be a feeling you want to do something.
And
that was exactly my situation at that moment. So I just didn't know, wow, but I have a feeling I want to go to East Malaysia, Borneo.
So
I had no vision of revelation.
I just
had a desire.
So
I asked this woman, "Have you ever been to East Malaysia?" Oh, yes. I was there a month ago.
I know
this pastor and his church. Oh, they want to have visit. They want to have visitors.
Here
is his name and his telephone number.
He says,
I got it. I called this man. I got in touch with him and they say, "Welcome, please come." I arrived to that address some weeks later. It is way up in the forest, in the jungle.
But
the church is big, 1,000 members.
So
here this pastor, he comes up to me and his wife. And they say, "You will bring revival to us."
tasala pasta pala aji hong paya nang se se ko makuma khatlo na hong po tuni hi chin
what
bangiam che
ka I think you got the wrong person
nang ahingo khatson
mai bate I mean we are very fresh very new missionaries
aya mara bangchi yam chile
we have no experience
tabang dan
No. We know God has sent you, and God has spoken to us that you will bring revival to our area.
Tabang dan Hong Chi Ta Chen Kei Ka Ter Zou Bua, Pa Chen Na Siam Ta Ki Pan Piang Mission Teng Piang. Aya Amana He Ki Hi Ter Zou Ki Nang Ma Se Go Sung A.
I think.
Kan Lo Na Po Tu Ni Chi Hong Sun Hi.
I don't think so.
Um Le Bong Ka Na Chi.
You got the wrong person.
Um Le Bong Ho Kei Ki Mong Le Bong
Ka Na Chi. But they believed.
Aya Amana Na Um Hi.
So I said, okay, let's see what happens.
Nong Um Le La.
And.
I
was at the right time, at the right place, and I met the right people.
And
that is enough. Can God use a donkey in the Old Testament to speak out of the mouth of a donkey? He can surely use us, you and me.
And I tell you,
something miraculous happened during those days. The Holy Spirit came like a wind. People were received Jesus and people were worshipping and there was a revival to begin.
I
went back many times to that area.
The
day the revival broke out, there was three white doves that came flying from nowhere and moved in to live in the ceiling of the church.
You
know, the dove is a symbol of the Holy Spirit.
And
it was a work of God. And he kept on and on.
No,
because I worked in that area, they gave me a name, a local name. They gave me the name of Huguan. My name is Hakan. But they gave me Huguan. It means, you know, good leader, a great leader.
I have
four names. I have one Chinese name. I have one, you know, East Malaysian name.
Malaysia, this one is Sangtai Minyakanehi.
I have one Indian name.
India Minyakanehi.
But I also have a Burmese name.
Kor Minyakanelahi.
But you don't want to know that.
I know, never have a bow with it.
No, it a bit, they gave me the name of Ong Lin.
I am
proud of that name. I like it.
Is it Ong Lin?
Ong Lin. Ong Lin.
Amen.
And it's a grace of God. We see here when Ruth has an expectancy.
It
opens the way.
And
then God is able to do something.
She
did not know exactly what was going to happen.
But
the expectancy of God's love, of God's goodness.
That
puts us in the right place to meet the right people at that right time.
And
when we are there, the grace of God is released for people to be touched.
Now,
I am sure we all can you know, talk about these kind of situations.
I tell you,
I was telling Pastor yesterday about my friend, the Arabic friend I have. He's a marvelous minister.
He
comes from a very rich and influential family in one of the strong Muslim nations. His father was a vice president over a nation. But he was converted by the grace of God. And God is using him mightily. He has many disciples now in the Saudi Arabia and Yemen and other nations. He never meets these people normally. Because he cannot.
But
for them to be baptized, he will put them in contact, because we're talking people from Saudi Arabia, Muslims from Saudi Arabia and Yemen.
He
put them in touch with pastors in Jordan or Lebanon or Egypt.
So they
go to visit those countries, and there they meet the pastor, and the pastor will take and baptize them. But 4 weeks ago, my friend, he was flying to Singapore. So he had agreed with 7 of these Muslims from Saudi Arabia to come to Doha in Qatar. Doha is the capital of Qatar.
That
he would meet them there, because he was having 12 hours stopover in Doha before going to Singapore.
So he
gets out of the airport and he goes into a taxi, and he tells the taxi driver to go to the place where he's going. But before he does that, something strange happens. Without him even wanting to say what he says something. He says to this taxi driver,
"I am
a Christian minister. I have come to baptize 7 Muslims here from Saudi Arabia."
So
he gets scared. Why did I say that?
He's
extremely careful. Extremely careful. He never says anything like that. Twice they already tried to assassinate him in Sweden.
And he
knows his father, his family want to kill him as soon as they see him.
And so he is
very careful, very careful where he is going, what he is doing. But here he says this thing, and he just get to be a bit afraid. The taxi driver says, "What?" But you know, the taxi driver has become Christian 1 year earlier. He, his family, and his son, who is 15 years old. They have never met a Christian, and they have been praying that God would send them a Christian. So here he steps into the car. And 1 year ago, the man had a dream. In the dream, a man steps into his taxi. And the man tells him that, "I have come to baptize 7 Muslims, and with you and your family, there will be 10 who will be baptized."
And
that is exactly what happened. He baptized all 10 people on his way to Singapore.
Now
that is a perfect person, perfect time, and perfect place. I know that Samuel did not know exactly what was going to happen. He had just wanted to meet his friends, and he agreed to meet them in Doha.
And
he walked into a situation that God had already prepared. Why am I saying this? I'm saying this because the book of Ruth speaks about the same thing. You know, if you continue to read the book of Ruth, you will see how the grace of God came to Ruth. But it started when she had this expectation. And the same thing goes for all of us. And I have learned over the years now, I come to understand that God will give us like small road signs. I call them road signs.
It
will catch your attention. Something strange or something unusual happens. And you stop and you start to think, well, is this God? Has God been here? Is God preparing something?
Amen.
And when God can get our attention that something is going to happen here,
then we are
open to be used by the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. I can't tell you many stories, but I know it's but this is how we started ministry in Japan. How I happened to meet a Japanese pastor in a church in Singapore. I never go to that church normally.
Singapore, Japan pastor, pato kakimua. Talamun biense yung kapaingay mun na yung ahibo.
But that pastor just happened to have been to one church in Sweden who was my friend, whom I just have left. I mean, I've met him 1 week earlier.
To pastor pa yung sa Sweden sa unting kat ngay kat abang matimu.
What? How could this be? I didn't have no intention of going to Japan. But because of that thing, I said, okay, I said yes to the invitation from this pastor.
Japanese.
I went to Japan. And the first person I met in Japan
was
a total stranger to me. But he was a relative to my pastor's secretary in Sweden.
And
because of that situation, we started a ministry there. The same thing happened in Myanmar and in Nepal. God gives us many, many of these opportunities. It says here in one of the Psalms, Psalm 85, I think it is. Yeah, Psalm 85. The title of this psalm is Favor to the Land. And if we read from verse 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Let me read in English and then you can read in Jin.
Okay.
Or Burmese.
Yeah, Burmese.
I will hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people and to his saints. But let them not turn back to folly. Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. This is symbolic of the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm sure. Yes, the Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him, and shall make his footsteps our pathway.
Tara Shem Piarkindi, a better Mindo Mumigo Nana Taumi. Akasan said, Mimi do, Mimi Tashin to the war, Ning the Chiajahu Mindo Muling me. Though you are doing not a pair, my dog a chingo, Machin Chabazine. Narope night bone or chain with me a chow. Getting no mujin, Jesuiti, Piarkin will chow your daughter to eat, a needle eat my young lady. Gruna netasa so maybe, Diana Chandati, the bag of the bar nanjabi. Tessa di Mijida appalling me, Diadi le, Gangimboa, Gongji lay me. A case is the Tara Piadi, Jesu Pura Muye, Narome the Mimi Banago bailing me, Diadi shit on a toy, Chido Yadoku, Pepin lay me.
It says that righteousness will go before.
To Chiam Nasir, Imaya Apaitu Hichinson.
Jesus is our righteousness.
Topai Susa, Imai to Chiam Nahi.
We are the righteousness of God in Him.
Asa Pacheni to Chiam Na, Topai Hisuma.
We have received a resurrection life.
Asa talking na Varana.
We have the Holy Spirit.
Tachanto inahi.
We have received the grace of God.
We
stand in the grace of God.
We
walk in the grace of God. We live in the grace of
God.
The grace of God is a power to lift us and to bring us forward to our destination. It is the righteousness of God that will move before us.
And he will
prepare the way.
And
it says here that we will find his footsteps. The things that he has prepared beforehand.
And as I say,
we may not know it with our mind, all the details, or even larger things that is ahead of us, but he will still do it in us.
You know,
as we can see from the book of Ruth, she made a priority to stay in that field. In fact, Boaz, who is a picture of Jesus, told her, stay in this field, don't go anywhere else.
And
Ruth say, why do I receive this favor from you?
And
Boaz says, well, I've heard how you were loyal and faithful to Naomi, your mother-in-law.
You know,
all these things attract and open the door for the grace of God to operate in our lives.
And
sometimes greater things happen than we can even imagine. Sometimes it could just be a small thing. Everyday experience. But let's say you go to New York. And you are going into a shoe shop there. And suddenly you see someone that you recognize.
Wow.
You went to school with that person back home in Myanmar. Wow, what are you doing here? Oh, what a coincidence.
Stop.
Is that a coincidence? Or maybe God has prepared something.
Because
often we just say that, oh, what a coincidence. And then we carry on our life.
But
maybe God wanted to catch your attention.
So
he gave you a little road sign to create, to touch, to take your awareness, elimina, to get your attention.
Because
it is when he gets our attention, he can begin to speak to us clearly.
Attention,
it starts from him. He moves and he works in our mind, in our emotions and our will.
And
when we yield to that, what we feel, he will lead us to the right person at the right time.
And
we will end up there, he will also let his power work through you to touch that person. Maybe for healing. Maybe salvation, maybe some blessing you would, you know, minister to
them.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It happens in the small things, it happens in the greater things.
Because
God loves you so much. And what he desires from all of us is that we should just love him. It's not what we can do or should do for him, but it's just what we can receive from him. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other, it says. Righteousness and peace. Mercy and truth. His loving kindness. You know, at the end of that story in the book of Ruth,
it says
that Boaz, if you know, remember the story, Boaz throws his mantle over her as she is laying by his feet. You understand?
Could you please repeat again?
Ruth wants to be blessed by Boaz, so she kind of come close to him, and he throw his mantle over her. He puts his mantle over her. To throw the mantle over someone was symbolic of making, you know, a wedding, of getting married to someone. You know, this whole story, it's a story of intimacy, of love. It is in that meeting, the power of God is truly released in our lives. We see miracles. I think my time is out. Amen.
Amen.
But praise God, there were so many things I would like to have told you, share with you, but it's no time. But I can tell you that I fell in love with Myanmar
in 1988.
And all those times I have come and gone and been in Myanmar.
And
all the beautiful people I've met. It's been some of the greatest moments in my life to be in meetings in Myanmar and to have fellowship and enjoy.
So
you are very special to me.
You are very special to me.
Amen. And all brothers and sisters,